there's a long history of people with diabetes having to advocate for access to our own data. There were clinicians who thought that patients should come to the hospital to get their blood sugar tested, and people with diabetes shouldn't do that at home because they might do something with the data.
They called us rogue cowboys at first and didn't understand why we would possibly want to see blood sugars all the time.
There have been a number of concerning periods in my life where I didn't necessarily know where my next supply of insulin was going to come from.
Imagine you're driving a car and you could only look at the speedometer four times a day. That would be kind of what it is like living with diabetes prior to the CGM. Continuous glucose monitors are an incredible innovation for people living with diabetes. It changed how people living with diabetes were able to monitor their blood sugar and not just see those points in time a half dozen times a day, but actually see where their blood sugar was and where their blood sugar was going.
And if you're lucky enough to have a continuous glucose monitor, theoretically it has an alarm that can wake you up. Many people, they get alarm fatigue because they hear these alarms all day, every day. And so their brain can be less likely to wake them up at night.
As a mom, it's a huge worry. Sydney would go to school and ignore all of those alarms. She wanted diabetes to be invisible. She wanted to be the same as all the other kids. So I went to the internet and I found Night Scout. Night Scout was created by parents of children living with type 1 diabetes as a way to view CGM readings remotely. Once we had Night Scout set up, it allowed me to have a display that had her blood sugar on it all the time on a little tablet.
Alexa, ask Night Scout how Sydney's doing.
6.9 and holding as of 5 minutes ago.
We've been able to set up a system so that she'll wake up on her own using Night Scout. Having access to all of her health data is really important for her. It's a team effort. Her doctor and I and herself, you know, can look at the data from Night Scout and make adjustments. And this allowed her to be more proactive about how she was managing her diabetes.
I actually started OpenAPS because I was frustrated first with not being able to hear the alarm on my continuous glucose monitor if my blood sugar was dangerously low overnight. I lived by myself, and that was a problem for me because my brain was very used to the alarms and didn't think it was important enough to wake up for. I asked the companies to make a louder CGM alarm, allow me to change the alarm, and they would keep saying, "We're working on it, it's coming out in the next version." Well, months and years passed and that didn't change. And I thought to myself, if I could get access to my glucose data from my continuous glucose monitor in real time, I could send it to the cloud and down to my phone and use my own alarm system instead of relying on the physical device. Instead of being just a reactive alarm, we added the ability for it to predict into the future. Then later, we figured out how to communicate with the insulin pump. And then from there, it was very easy to close the loop, so to speak, where the pump and the CGM would communicate with the computer, run the data through the algorithm, and then instead of telling me as the human what to do, or generating an alarm to get me to take action, it would automatically take action by adjusting the insulin delivery on my pump. Our goal in building the system was to build it for myself and then share it so that if one more person wanted to use it to sleep safely at night with that same peace of mind that I've had every night for the past 6 years.
My role with Tidepool is CEO, and I also am a dad of a young woman living with type 1 diabetes. Tidepool's mission is to make diabetes data more actionable, meaningful, and accessible. Most device makers do not openly publish their device data protocols, and very few devices are based on open standards. But from a Tidepool perspective, we feel like starting with an open source platform has lots of benefits. It means we can leverage the work that the community has done. It also means that we can openly publish the work we're doing. There are many clinicians who are hesitant to suggest an open source do-it-yourself solution. And there are many people living with diabetes who are hesitant to build a solution themselves. We were selected to be a part of the FDA pre-certification pilot program, which means that we're coming up with new methods for helping the FDA evaluate software as a medical device. We sometimes like to say we have pancreas in the game. That's a reference to how many people working at Typewell are actually living with diabetes themselves and have challenged pancreases. But it's also testament to the fact that we attract people who really want to do something great for the entire diabetes community. By building on the shoulders of the giants in the do-it-yourself community, we're able to take that incredible work, bring it to the FDA, eventually get FDA clearance, and then put it in the App Store. So people will be able to access Typewell Lube, and doctors will be able to prescribe it knowing that it's an FDA-cleared system.
Committed to making insulin that is absolutely as safe and as reliable as what you get at the pharmacy now. So we want this to be FDA approved. We want it to go through the whole process so that people really are comfortable using our product. We are trying to essentially make insulin that's very similar to the insulin that's already on the market. Insulin is an old, old drug. It was discovered over 100 years ago, and it's been expressed in cells the way that we do since the 70s.
The price of insulin can be tremendously high if you don't have insurance or some other way of getting insulin at an affordable price.
A major study found that 25% of diabetics are currently rationing their insulin.
And when you do that, you start to risk very serious complications of diabetes that can often be fatal.
And Open Insulin's goal is to make the production of insulin more accessible and put it back in the hands of the people who need it.
The sustainability of this kind of project, we really aim to build the most possible open source tools and try to get away from everything which is proprietary.
There may be all kinds of technical and other challenges that come up along the way, but you know, it's entirely possible to work through them and to get something that is, you know, second to none. And that's exactly what we're trying to do with the production of insulin itself.
The production of insulin, if everything works the way we want, will probably look like a small brewery. So when you go to your local brewery and you see this kind of big tank, you know, one of those big tanks can probably produce for the whole city.
The more we can make insulin accessible and available, the better off it will be to help with that management process. Life and death medications should not have a profit motive behind them. Medications should be available to everybody regardless of cost.
This is all part of the big open source diabetes community, where the other open source automated insulin delivery projects are really great examples of open source projects that came together regardless of geography, nothing in common except for wanting to make tools to help other people make life with diabetes better.
When we all give back, when we all pay it forward, when we all put our code out in open source, it helps everyone take advantage of all of the great work that's going on.
We feel like the more things can be open and accessible, the more interesting and beneficial work is going to happen. It's all in service of the public good.